I am Jean Giralskis, Executive Director of the McAuliffe-Shepard Discovery Center and your moderator for today. I'm pleased to welcome you to the Monadnock Summer Lyceum with today's guest speaker, Dr. Ellen Stofan. Before we get started, I'd like to thank today's musicians, the Tamarack Chamber Group, for recording the music many of you enjoyed while waiting for the live broadcast to begin. Also, thank you to New Hampshire's own Air and Space Museum, the McAuliffe-Shepard Discovery Center, for generously sponsoring today's event. For many years, the Monadnock Summer Lyceum has brought outstanding world-class speakers to the Monadnock region to serve as catalysts to inform, engage, and inspire an active citizenry on local, national, and global issues. The Monadnock Summer Lyceum is supported primarily through contributions from our audience. We deeply appreciate your donations, which this year may be made on our website or by mailing your donation in. During this challenging time, we need your help more than ever. Today's talk is being recorded and will soon be available as a podcast and as a video on our website, monadnocklyceum.org. The talk will also be rebroadcast on WSMN next Sunday at 7 a.m. and at 4 p.m. and on WUML this coming Wednesday at 10 a.m. As is the tradition of the Lyceum, after the presentation, our speaker will answer questions from the audience. Please submit your questions by using the live comments section on Facebook or YouTube, or send them to our email at monlyceum@gmail.com. That's monlyceum@gmail.com. After the broadcast, you may provide feedback on today's program, suggestions for next summer speakers, or join our mailing list through our website. Our speaker today is Dr. Ellen Stofan. Every child likes to play in the dirt. We like to see what it feels like, looks like, what it's made of, what lives in it. We like to collect rocks to compare their color, shape, to scrape or bash them against other rocks and see what happens. Every child is a geologist at heart. For some, this fascination can become a lifelong passion and vocation. They choose to become professional geologists. And a very few of these geologists take it up a notch. They look to the heavens and investigate the nature, composition, and evolution of our neighboring planets and moons, from the highest level of the moons and planets' atmospheres to their varied and unusual surfaces to their deepest cores. These select few are planetary geologists, and Dr. Ellen Stofan is one of them. Dr. Stofan has spent a lifetime studying the geology of Venus, Earth, Mars, and Saturn's largest moon, Titan. Now serving as Undersecretary for Science and Research at the Smithsonian Institution, she directs and oversees its many scientific initiatives, including biodiversity, global health, climate change, species conservation, astrophysics, and the search for life beyond our solar system. Prior to her role as Undersecretary, Dr. Stofan was the first woman to direct the most visited museum in the world, and my favorite place in Washington, D.C., the National Air and Space Museum. During her 3 years at the helm, she kicked off the museum's major 7-year renovation and shepherded it through the height of the pandemic, perhaps the most challenging year in all of our lifetimes. And before that, Dr. Stofan was deeply engaged in planetary geology, going to work for and playing a leadership role at NASA, just like her rocket scientist dad before her. She served as NASA's chief scientist, as chief scientist for the New Millennium Project at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, and as an active member of the scientific teams who have brought us a new understanding of the basic nature of our home planet and its neighbors. It is my great pleasure to welcome Dr. Stofan as today's speaker.
Jean, thank you so much. And thank you so much to the Lyceum for having me here today. And thank you especially to my cousin, Bob Herring-Smith, who helped invite me. And I'm really so sorry that I can't be with you all in person today. This past year and a half has been really tough, but virtual works, that's something that we've all learned. And I'm hoping that at some point I will actually get up to New Hampshire and be able to visit the Lyceum in person, as well as the McAuliffe-Shepard Discovery Center. So I thought it would be fun today to talk about this topic that certainly with all the recent news about UFOs, people has been very much in the news. And most of you are also really used to seeing constant seemingly news releases about finding water on Mars. So I wanted to put this whole question of searching for life beyond Earth into a broad context. And the broadest context I wanted to put it in was certainly the fact that I think ever since there have basically been people looking up into the night sky, we have wondered, are we alone? Is there life beyond this planet? And it's only really been in the last several decades that we actually have the tools to actually start answering that question, which I find incredibly interesting. You know, a lot of people think, and I think a lot of kids think, oh, all the science out there has been discovered. And I can tell you from our work at the Smithsonian, but certainly in this particular area of searching for life beyond Earth, the future is really in front of us. I also wanted to couch this discussion, believe it or not, in science fiction. I'm a huge science fiction fan. I have been reading science fiction my entire life. And really, to me, science fiction is a way of exploring what we wonder about, what the future could be. We all see so much science fiction, obviously, some of it predicts a very optimistic future, you know, think Star Wars, Star Trek, where we're out there exploring the galaxy, exploring the universe. But a lot of it is very dystopian. And it might surprise some people to know that we actually explore science fiction quite a bit at the National Air and Space Museum. We have the model that was used in filming Close Encounters of the Third Kind. We have the model that was used for Star Trek, the entire series of the Starship Enterprise. I'm sorry to tell you, it's only about 3 feet across, but it's in a very expensive case that keeps it safe. And our proudest artifact that we just recently acquired that we're incredibly excited about on loan from Disney is an X-Wing fighter. It's an actual size X-Wing fighter, so it's quite large. I was just there on Friday at our Udvar-Hazy Center in Chantilly, Virginia, taking a look at it. It's really amazing. Because first of all, it's amazing how Lucasfilm really made it look beat up. For one thing, it's really fun to get up close to it. And everyone, I will say, side plug for the Air and Space Museum, if you go out right now to our Chantilly facility, through the windows, you can look down into the restoration hangar and see the X-Wing fighter assembled down on the floor while we're working on how to figure out how to hang it up in the renovated museum downtown in a couple years. So why do we have all that stuff at the Air and Space Museum? Why do we have all these movie and TV props at a museum that's supposed to be, you know, talking about the important science we do around aviation and space exploration? It gets back to something I heard on NPR, and I've never been able to figure out who it was that said it, but I definitely didn't come up with this. The person was talking about all the things from science fiction that have now been invented. Think cell phones, you know, the communicators from Star Trek. There's actually a challenge out right now to develop a tricorder so that we could remotely assess human health. So they were talking about this, and someone on the show said, no one ever invented something that someone didn't imagine first. And I absolutely love that. And that's why we have so much science fiction at the Air and Space Museum. From you, when you enter our new renovated gallery about the Apollo exploration of the moon and beyond, the first thing that you see, you're going to see when you come into that renovated gallery, which will open in 22, is a whole thing about how did we imagine humans going to the moon? What did we imagine the moon would be like? Because to me, that imagination helps drive us forward. People imagined rocket, they imagined rockets, they imagined spaceflight and traveling from planet to planet in through science fiction long before we ever did it. And so I really like to couch this search for life beyond Earth, because we've really explored all kinds of different options of what life beyond Earth would actually be. And I'm afraid the bulk of what I'm going to be talking about today is not the life that we imagine from science fiction. You know, little green men, strange aliens that seem to want to eat us for unknown reasons. Because if they could travel across the universe, why would they be so hungry? You know, this idea that when we're searching for life, we have to go back and think about the very origins of life here on Earth. And I'll come back to that later in the talk. One of the most amazing images that NASA has returned, in my opinion, one of the most beautiful and amazing images, came about, gosh, it was probably about 15 years ago, from the Hubble Space Telescope. And it's called the Hubble Deep Field image. They took the Hubble telescope and they pointed it at the darkest point of the night sky in its field of view, where you basically couldn't see any stars. And they left the camera exposure open for a long time so that it was collecting photons. It was collecting light from very, very, very far away. And of course, most of you know, if you're collecting light from far away, it's taken a long time to get to you. So you're essentially looking back in time. And the deep field image that was returned from those series of observations is the deepest we've been able to look into the history of the universe. And in fact, that image actually shows us what the deep universe looked like about 13 billion years ago. So only about 500 to 800 million years after the Big Bang. And what we saw in that image was actually stunning. We saw over 10,000 galaxies in that image, all kinds of different galaxies. Why is that interesting? Okay, now remember, only about 800 million years had gone by since the Big Bang, and yet we already saw incredible structure in the universe, already with galaxies. So that means we already had stars, we had groups of stars, they gravitationally attracted into galaxies. There's a black hole at the center of most galaxies. Did we already have black holes by that point? We're not sure. But we probably had planets at that point, because if we had galaxies, it's very likely that we had planets. So fascinating. So this history of the universe, but not just the history of the universe, but of complexity in the universe, which is important for getting to life, goes back extremely far. Now, the next most exciting thing in this story to me was another space-based telescope that we've had called the Kepler Space Telescope. Now, Kepler looked at a very narrow part of the night sky. It was just focused in one area. And what it was doing was looking for planets that were transiting in front of stars. So how would it do that? Well, it would stare at a specific star and it would wait until the light slightly dimmed out from that star as the planet passed in front of it. Now, from how that light dims out, you can actually calculate the size of the planet and how far it is from its parent star if you know something about the star. Now, what Kepler found over its mission lifetime was over 3,500 planets around other stars. Now, even more importantly, it found many, many planets in the size between Earth and Neptune. And some of those planets, the distance from their parent star where water could be stable on the surface. But I think even more importantly, Kepler was only looking at a very narrow portion out into the galaxy, very narrow portion. And basically every star it looked at, it found planets around it, 7 planet systems, 5 planet systems, 3 planet systems. What that tells us is just about every star that you can see in the night sky, high probability that it has a planetary system around it. Now go back to that Hubble Deep Field image and think about the fact that all those stars in all those galaxies, as some of us of a certain vintage would say, we remember Carl Sagan saying, billions and billions of stars out there, billions of planets, all of a sudden the odds of there being life around another planet become high. Now, I mentioned the importance of this issue about distance from a parent star and water. Why is water important? Well, we have to be careful when we go into these discussions because we have one data point, 111, And anybody knows when you have one data point and you develop giant scientific theories around it, you're going to learn as you gather more data. And some of the assumptions that you're making could be valid, but more data might say, wait a minute, the story is a lot more complicated than that. So when we talk about searching for life in the universe, we are incredibly biased by what happened here on Earth. And what we know from our solar system is that life evolved on a water world, Earth. So water, why is water important? Well, first of all, there's properties of the water molecule. It's the fact that it's bipolar. It's got certain properties, the fact that it forms a liquid. Membranes form in liquids. You need membranes are obviously part of cell structures. So we think that there are a lot of aspects to water, to not just its chemical and physical properties that allow the chemical reactions that go on to become biochemical reactions that could allow life to form. You also need organic molecules to form life. We're made of organic molecules. But actually, that's not really the toughest issue, because we've detected organic molecules, amino acids, in asteroids and comets. And we've even detected amino acids in interstellar clouds. So the building blocks of life are actually fairly ubiquitous. So if you bring those building blocks of life in, you combine them with water, and you provide a little energy, lightning, energy from a volcanic eruption, we think that's where you get the chemical reactions that can proceed towards the evolution of life. So when we start searching for life beyond Earth, what we're really looking for is a water world, because remember that organic molecule part is easy. And frankly, as somebody who studies volcanoes for a living, the volcano part is pretty easy. Pretty much every planet we've looked on and moon in the solar system that has any kind of internal heat, you get volcanoes. So those are the easy parts. The hard part is actually the water. So it turns out there's something that we call the habitable zone, and that's the distance from a parent star where water can be stable on the surface of a planet. But of course, it's more complicated than just the distance from the star. The planet has to have an atmosphere. It has to have enough greenhouse gases that the planet is warm enough for water to be a liquid, but not too much, say Venus, where the water would boil off because of the heat. So in our solar system, people have written about the habitable zone and actually compared it to Goldilocks. You have Venus, which is too hot on the inner side of the habitable zone. You have Mars, which is on the outer part of the habitable zone, too cold. And you have Earth, which is, of course, just right. But the story is actually, of course, as it always is, more complicated than that. And if you think about the fact that if now we're out again searching for Earth 2.0 around another star, we're going to have to find Earth at the right point in its history. Now we are a water world. When Earth first formed, it was covered in a magma ocean. The whole surface had melted of the planet. So we could find magma ocean Earth before life, the conditions ever stabilized enough here on this planet to get Earth. We could look at early Earth around another star where the planet, say, would be a blue-green color because it would be dominated, would be an ocean world, but it would be dominated by cyanobacteria, which has this blue-green color. And we think the Earth was like that at one point. We also could find snowball Earth. At one point, we're pretty sure most of the Earth's surface was covered in ice. So as we think about this habitable zone, the habitable zone is not just a place, and it's not just all these other requirements. It also could be a point in time. And again, for the last about 3.5 billion years, the Earth's surface has been habitable. Before that, not so much. And there's been some dodgy moments in between. And even with Venus and Mars, and I'll come back quite a bit to Mars later, there's a chance that very early in its history, for a brief point of time, we know Venus had an ocean's worth of water on its surface. So it too could have been habitable. And the same is definitely true of Mars. We know about 3.5 billion years ago, Mars had an ocean's worth of water on its surface. Now, again, go back to this fact. those places would have also had those amino acids on the surface because comets and asteroids also impacted their surfaces just like they did Earth, delivering that. We know Mars and Venus both had volcanoes. So if you have these bodies where the conditions are very similar and you know that life could have evolved and it had enough time, that's the other problem. We know that life evolved very rapidly here on Earth once conditions stabilized, once we got rid of that magma ocean Earth, we had water on the surface almost right away, within a few hundred million years, that's right away to a geologist, conditions stabilized enough that you could actually, that we know that very primitive bacteria started forming on Earth, very single-celled organisms started appearing on the Earth. So in the oceans, stayed in the oceans for over a billion years. So complex life like us came much, much later. So it took a very long time for life on Earth to get out of the oceans and to get it all complex. So you need time. So if you only sit in that habitable zone for a short amount of time, did life ever have time to evolve? And did it ever have the chance to become at all complex beyond a single-celled organism? The other complexity you have to worry about, and people have created very complex charts to show this, there are all kinds of factors, not just the organics, not just the water, not just the distance, but more complicated things about planetary evolution. Did the planet have a magnetic field? And this is a really critical factor that protected it from incoming radiation. Radiation breaks up organic molecules, so you don't want that. That's why radiation is bad for us. But around Earth, for example, which has a very strong magnetic field, we have the Van Allen radiation belts that helps deflect solar radiation and cosmic radiation away from the Earth. That's why we always really worry with things like the ozone hole, because that actually that allows more radiation to get to the surface of the Earth. Mars, again, back to Mars. Mars only had a magnetic field for a very brief point in time. Venus, we're still confused about. So anyway, so where are we? All right, we're at the point searching for life beyond Earth. We know from Kepler that there are thousands of planets out there. We know we have got planets that are in what could be the habitable zone around another star. So what's the next step? The next step is the James Webb Space Telescope, which will launch next year. And this new telescope that will be launched, which is an infrared telescope, is really important because James Webb will actually take that next step and start looking at the atmospheres around planets around other stars. So, okay, that first step, does the planet have an atmosphere? Now, what is the composition of that atmosphere? Can we find things in that atmosphere like carbon dioxide, oxygen, methane, gases that are associated with life? That doesn't prove there's life, but finding them, and frankly, finding them potentially out of equilibrium, which tells you there's some kind of active process going on, could be volcanism, could be life, or being able to go back and look at that planet's atmosphere numerous times and seeing a lot of change. That would tell you there's something dynamic going on. Again, could be geology, but could be life. So James Webb is going to take us the next step. Beyond that, we need to develop telescopes, very, very large telescopes that can help us actually image a planet around another star. Because obviously, imaging the Earth gives us a huge clue that there's life on Earth because we can see colors change across the surface of our planet from space as the seasons wax and wane and you get vegetation changes across the surface. So actually being able to image a planet will get us to that next step. So I've been really focusing on planets around other stars. So how can we use our own solar system to help start pushing at these questions? And I want to go back to that habitable zone concept again, Venus, Earth, Mars. As I said, Venus could have sustained life very early in its history. Again, we know an ocean's worth of water has actually escaped from the surface. Venus and Mars both have the problem that lacking a magnetic field, their atmosphere, the top of their atmosphere gets heavily modified by the top of the solar wind particles streaming from the sun. And so we know from looking at ratios of isotopic hydrogen in Venus's atmosphere that at one point it had water, the water molecule broke apart, and it lost a lot of that out the top of its atmosphere. Mars also lost a lot of its atmosphere from solar wind stripping. And so that's a problem. Venus still has most of its atmosphere, which is why it's a runaway greenhouse atmosphere. The carbon dioxide that here on Earth is tied up in rocks, in plants, in us. On Venus, all that carbon dioxide is in the atmosphere, which gives it not just a greenhouse atmosphere. All three planets have greenhouse gases, carbon dioxide and methane in their atmosphere. But Venus has way too much carbon dioxide, and therefore has a what's called a runaway greenhouse, where the temperature has gone to 500 degrees centigrade on the surface of Venus. This is why back in the late 80s and 90s, when I was working on Venus, and people would say greenhouse gases don't cause heating and greenhouse and climate change isn't real. And you're like, excuse me, look at Venus. And I've actually been at conferences where scientists have argued, could we get to a tipping point on Earth where the greenhouse effect here could go into this runaway state and actually boil off the oceans on Earth? It turns out we can't quite get enough carbon dioxide into Earth's atmosphere to boil off the oceans, but we can certainly get it high enough if we burned all the fossil fuels to get the Earth to an uninhabitable state. So let's not do that. So again, back to our own solar system. Three chances for life. Earth worked out. Venus maybe would have gone extinct as Venus got too hot. Mars, and I'm going to come back to Mars because, again, it turned out from about 3.5 to 4 billion years ago, Mars had an ocean's worth of water on its surface. Then Mars lost its magnetic field. The solar winds started stripping away its atmosphere. It got very, very cold on its surface. And without that magnetic field, the surface was getting radiated. So life either retreated underground, where it could still be, or it went extinct. But as is usual in science, when you think you have a good story, there are exceptions to this good story. So the exception in our to this habitable zone concept in our solar system are the icy moons of the outer solar system. Okay, outer solar system, way far out in the solar system, temperatures very cold on moons or planets. So no liquid water on the surface. So you'd say, all right, no liquid water on the surface. You told me I needed that for the habitable zone planets. Okay, but what about under the surface of those planets? And it turns out, starting with the Voyager spacecraft and then the Galileo spacecraft at Jupiter and the Cassini spacecraft at Saturn, we have found out that under several of the moon's surface, icy crust surfaces, and those crusts are actually made of water ice. It's so cold out there, the water ice behaves like rock. Under those icy crusts, there are actually liquid water oceans, substantial liquid water oceans. And we've actually had good proof of that at two of the moons, Europa at Jupiter and Enceladus at Saturn. Now, theoretically, we could figure out from watching the moon, it's how it flexes as the gravity of its giant planet affects it. Looking at the surfaces, we theorized that there was a liquid water ocean under the icy crust. But luckily for us, we could go beyond theory to actual proof at both Europa and Enceladus, because that liquid water ocean is actually erupting out of the planet through cracks in its surface. And at both Europa, which we've observed water eruptions from Europa with the Hubble Space Telescope, we do turn that telescope back to our own solar system. But also at Enceladus with the Cassini spacecraft, we saw water, basically almost think of them like geysers, erupting from the surface of Enceladus. So we actually flew the Cassini spacecraft low over the surface of Enceladus, right through those erupting plumes, and measured what was coming out. What was coming out was water. Okay, that's also how we know it's, we were definitely right about it being water, liquid water under the surface. We measured salts and silica. Why is that important? That says that at the base of that water ocean, there's rock. Those icy moons probably have rocky cores. The silica tells you there's all kinds of different elements there that would be basically nutrition for life. Same with the salts. And we also measured organic molecules. Now, unfortunately, the Cassini instrument was not designed to measure really big organic molecules. It wasn't that complicated of an instrument. So we don't know how big they are. Organic molecules associated with life tend to be very complex, lots of carbon, hydrogen, nitrogens attached to it. So they tend to be very long chain, complicated organic molecules. So we don't know if what we were quite detecting, because we didn't have the right instrument. So, okay, could be life in the outer solar system. I don't have time to get to Titan. Titan's an interesting story. It has no water, but it has oceans of liquid gasoline, liquid methane and ethane that might help us address the question of what are the limits of life in our solar system. Now to Mars. Okay, Mars is obviously one of the more studied planets in the solar system. And the reason for that is very early on in the exploration of Mars, we knew there was liquid water on the surface. We could see ancient dried up riverbeds on the surface. We've looked at the shoreline of what appears to be an ocean that would have covered most of the northern hemisphere of Mars. So we know Mars was a water world. These multiple spacecraft that we've sent to Mars have allowed us to come up with this pretty tight understanding, again, of this 500 million year period of water being stable on the surface. And not only that, the water being not too acidic, not too basic, so conditions in which life could have evolved. Did it? We're still trying to figure that out. So scientists have really started thinking, wait a minute, remember I said Cassini didn't have the right instrument to detect those complex organic molecules that would be life. How do you design an instrument that could find life? And I don't have time to go into it, but we sent an instrument back in 1976 on the Viking lander to search for life on Mars. But it turned out the instrument was designed at a stage where we had a very limited understanding of the chemistry of the surface of Mars. And so it got a negative result, but it turned out what it was measuring was, it's a complicated story, but we sent the wrong instrument and asked a little bit the wrong question. So when scientists start thinking, all right, what instrument do I send? How do I determine if there was life on Mars? The astrobiology community has really started coming up with, and would you know life if you saw it? So the astrobiology community has come up with something they call the ladder of life. And if you're more interested in more details behind it, you can actually Google NASA ladder of life. And it really says, all right, how do we find life on another planet? What is it exactly what we're looking for? And when you think of defining life, it actually gets a little complicated. Just because something wiggles, is it alive? Turns out, no, things can wiggle and not be alive. So you have to really start saying, what makes something living? And so we have this ladder of life. The first step you want to know, was it an environment that could have been habitable for Mars? Check. Then you start looking for other indications of life. For example, molecules associated with life tend to have their organic molecules arranged in a certain way. So do we see that type of arrangement? Then you start looking for things like, can we find functional molecules? So in our case, our functional molecules are DNA and RNA. Can we find evidence of that kind of chemistry that would tell you have something that's life? Then you start looking, is there evidence, for example, of metabolism? Can you see something that appears to be removing something from the environment and giving something else off? Think cows eating grass, giving off methane. And then you start looking for things like locomotion. And finally, the intrinsic to the definition, I will say, of life here on Earth is that it exhibits Darwinian evolution. Tough to prove, right? So when we send something like our Perseverance lander to Mars, we've got instruments on board that are looking. We now have those instruments that can identify complicated large organic molecules. That's certainly one of the things we've sent. We send now our spacecraft very carefully to places where we think those kinds of conditions exist. For example, Perseverance is right now at a place called Jezero Crater, where we know there were clay minerals on the surface. So that's telling you there was long-standing water on the surface. So we're going into those environments, and again, we're looking for the molecules, these complicated organic molecules. The other thing that Perseverance is going to do is it is actually caching samples, putting samples into little tubes for return to the Earth by a mission that we hope will go to Mars later in the 2020s. Because frankly, being able to bring that material back to the Earth where we have much more sophisticated laboratories is something that we want to do. And we know there have been bigger organic molecules on the surface of Mars because the Curiosity rover has actually found fragments of large organic molecules on the surface, but only fragments. Why? Because Mars, as I said before, has incoming radiation. It will break up organic molecules into these fragments. What we don't know is, did those fragments ever add up to something that could be life or something leading towards life? We don't know that yet, still working on it. So the Mars sample return will be the next step towards that. But in my opinion, the only way to really, really nail this down is to actually send humans to Mars, because you're gonna have to break open a lot of rocks looking for fossils of probably organisms that never went beyond either single-celled or with very simple levels of complexity. So if we really want to understand not just did life evolve on Mars, but what kind of complexity and variation did it gain, you're going to have to look at so many samples that having humans at some sort of scientific base camp collecting lots and lots of rocks and breaking them open and assessing what they find, you really need humans on Mars. And so that is part of the motivation, only part, whole complicated topic, we can, if you want to talk about that during the questions, of why we need to get humans to Mars. But of course, you know, we haven't sent humans out beyond low Earth orbit since the early 1970s. And getting to Mars is hard. First of all, it's far away. It's about 7 months to get to Mars with current propulsion technologies. And you're going to have to stay there for some amount of time and then 7 months to get back. So very long journey in space where humans are exposed to deep space radiation that we would have to shield them against, very kind of deprived conditions in space, just you and three or four or five of your closest friends in fairly close quarters. How do you get food to stay stable and nutritious? How do you get medications to stay stable and nutritious? And then when you get to Mars, Mars has this very thin atmosphere that heats you up as you enter it, but there's not enough atmosphere to slow you down. And so getting large amounts of material for all the stuff we would need to bring with us to get humans to Mars is actually quite a challenge. So lots of technological challenges in getting to Mars, but frankly, far fewer than in 1961 when President Kennedy really in that Rice University speech laid out, you know, why it was important to go to the moon. And then 8.5 years we landed on the moon. But think at that point, we didn't have spacesuits. We didn't have really actually working rockets at that point. We didn't know how to keep people alive in space. There was an awful lot we didn't know. And for Mars, we actually do know. We have the challenges really well defined and we've made huge progress. For those in the audience who are 21 or younger, part of for your entire life, there have been people living on the International Space Station. So we've been up on the International Space Station for 21 years now. And what we've been doing up there is doing this work to get humans ready to survive in space for very long durations. We've had Scott Kelly up for a year. We've had Peggy Whitson up for nearly a year. There's another astronaut that's about to be up there for a year. So, and most of the astronauts go up there for at least 6 months. So what we've been doing is really studying how do we get humans to stay healthy in microgravity for long periods of time? How did we develop the operations and equipment that we need, reliable equipment, the most trivial of which, but one of the more important is, can we have a working toilet? You don't want to go to Mars and have your toilet break, right? Not a good situation. And actually, that's one of the tougher things that we still are working on is how do we get a well-functioning toilet on the International Space Station? how do you recycle as much of your water? Water's heavy. You don't want to launch tons of water off the surface of the earth. And we now recycle over 85% of the water on the International Space Station. Yes, they do drink purified urine, the water that comes from, not purified urine, purified water that comes from urine is part of the water that's used for drinking now on the International Space Station. You have to do that. You have to be able to reduce, reuse, and recycle. And that's what we do. Up on the International Space Station, lots of lessons up there of things we're learning about sustainability. So we are making progress towards getting humans to Mars. And I'm actually optimistic that we'll have humans there within the next 20 years. And again, for the importance for me, isn't just the inspiration piece, which I do think is important, isn't just the investing in space exploration is an investment in our economy piece. It really is this piece that to really understand a possible second origin of life in our solar system, Mars is the place to go. And I strongly believe we need humans to do that. Now, I wanted to come back just briefly to this inspiration piece, because two summers ago, we were really struggling at the Air and Space Museum with how to commemorate the 50th anniversary of Apollo. I witnessed the Apollo landings, but over half the population now was born post-Apollo. How do you bring that moment of inspiration when humanity really was convinced momentarily that as humans, we could do anything we put our mind to, and we could really turn our energies the best and most positive of things, this idea of exploration. And so one of my staff came up with a crazy idea that we actually managed to execute of projecting the Saturn V rocket onto the Washington Monument. It turns out the Saturn V rocket is about the same height as the Washington Monument. And we did a huge sound and light show on the National Mall that you can see now. If you Google "Go for the Moon," you can watch the YouTube video of the show we put together. And the reason for it is, you know, PhDs in this country actually spiked post-Apollo. Apollo motivated an entire generation to go into STEM fields. Now, those people didn't all end up like me as planetary geologists. They were doctors. They were engineers. They were innovators. They were entrepreneurs. I mean, Jeff Bezos and Elon Musk have famously talked about how they were inspired by the Apollo program. So this point of space exploration is something inspirational I do think is important. And finally, what I wanted to just mention is that the Air and Space Museum, we've obviously long told the stories of people like the Wright brothers, these amazing bicycle makers from Ohio who really started looking at how can we actually get people to fly, and then succeeded. And we're proud to have the 1903 Wright Flyer in our collection. The Apollo astronauts, Collins, Armstrong, Aldrin, these amazing people who represented the 400,000 Americans who participated in getting humans to the moon. People like Chuck Yeager, who was the first American to break the speed of sound. But I would argue probably far fewer of you know who Bessie Coleman is. Bessie Coleman in the 1920s was African-American woman living in Chicago and decided she wanted to learn how to fly. This was years before Amelia Earhart, years before the Tuskegee Airmen. At that point, neither women nor Black Americans were allowed to get pilot's license. So she actually went to France to learn how to fly. And came back and flew at barnstorming shows, but she would only fly at shows that were desegregated. She's an absolute hero of mine. Eileen Collins, the first woman to pilot and then command the space shuttle. People like my former boss, Charlie Bolden, Black astronaut, flew on the shuttle four times, was the administrator of NASA. We need to be sure that we tell all of the stories of space exploration, of innovation, of discovery, so that every child has someone that they can look up to and say, someone who looked like me has actually achieved amazing things. So thank you very much for having me here today. And I'm hoping you all have lots of great questions.
Well, thank you, Ellen, for your insightful thoughts on life beyond Earth. We have time for some questions from the audience. And as our speaker responds to those already sent, you may continue to submit questions on the Facebook and YouTube comments or by sending an email to monlyceum@gmail.com. So here's a couple of questions. Of the NASA missions in which you were involved, I understand that Cassini was your favorite. Can you tell us why?
Yeah, and in fact, I even wore my Cassini shirt today. I started out working on radar missions because at the time I was working on my PhD, the Soviet Union, that's how old I am, the Soviet Union had two spacecraft that were just arriving at Venus, and they were radars so that they could see through the clouds on Venus down to the surface. So sort of without a plan, I became an expert in radar observations of planetary surfaces. And so at some point, the Cassini mission had already been planned, but the guy that was Charles Halachi that was leading the radar team said, oh, we need some more geologists. And Ellen, you know how to deal with radar data, and we're using this radar on Cassini. We're going to be using it to study this moon Titan that's covered in hazes and clouds. And I thought, you know, I really study Mars, Venus, and Earth. I don't really do the ice balls out in the outer solar system. It's not really my thing. But I said, okay, sure, you know, I'll do something different. And I started working on Cassini, and I so fell in love with Titan. Because here you have this world, you know, over, you know, way out at the other side of the solar system, incredibly cold. It's 91 degrees Kelvin on the surface of Venus. I never can remember what the conversion is, but that's really, really, really cold. And yet it's the only place we can go in the solar system to have where we have rivers flowing into seas, where you have active shoreline processes, where there are open bodies of liquid. But at that temperature, it's not water, it's liquid methane and ethane, as I said. But my whole thing and why I study planets is to really understand the Earth better. So here we are so far out in the solar system, and yet there are these Earth-like processes going on, shorelines being modified, deltas being laid down. And so it was just so exciting and marvelous to me that I totally fell in love with Titan, and then spent about 5 years trying to design a boat to go sail on one of those alien seas. We didn't actually become successful in that proposal, but there's now a mission plan to Titan that's actually a octocopter. So it's a little drone that'll fly around the equatorial region.
Wow. So how about Mars? Do you believe we'll eventually colonize Mars? Not just a station, but living there, working there, having children there. And would you comment on the recent Brandon and Bezos flights?
So we usually avoid that word colonize because it's a bit fraught from the history of colonization. So we prefer settle. So do I think we'll ever settle on Mars? The one thing that worries me in these conversations, and you've had some very famous people like Stephen Hawking had come out and said, you know, Mars is the place we're going to have to move humanity because we've messed up the Earth. And I always really want to emphasize, you know, there is no planet B. The Earth, as Carl Sagan famously said, the Earth is where we make our stand. This is the only habitable planet we have found in our solar system. And we don't have to get technology to go beyond our solar system. And so we will certainly, I think, have humans living on Mars. And we will have some sort of human outpost on Mars. But remember, I said the surface of Mars is radiated. So the only way to live on Mars is actually to live underground. So hard to grow food, hard to live, hard to sustain large numbers of people. Mars will have people on it one day. It will have people living on it and children being born. But it is not planet B. We got to fix this place. Second question was about the Bezos and Branson flights. Really excited about it, certainly not from a scientific point of view. But for one thing, again, let's go back to the science fiction. Huge fan of science fiction. My favorite COVID quarantine show was The Expanse, which I really love and shows this vision of humans living across our solar system, including on Mars, but out beyond Mars in the asteroid belt and on the surface of the moon. Now, to get to that future that I think many of us hold of humans moving out beyond the Earth, if you just solely rely on governments, it's not going to happen. And so what we've seen with the evolution over the last decade or so of commercial spaceflight, companies don't do things unless there's a profit motive. You have very early investment, often by people who realize they may not make money, but they're willing to help push the industry forward. And these people tend to be people who have a lot of money. We've seen that in other things. For example, like the development of aviation went down a not dissimilar path. And so what you see now are private companies stepping in to what NASA has made, certainly not routine, but available for private companies to actually start thinking that they could potentially make a profit. So getting cargo to low Earth orbit, getting humans potentially to low Earth orbit. And we saw this happen with the communications industry, where you had certainly in the very beginning, back in the 1960s, communication satellites were developed by the government. But then once companies realized they could make money, you had the private sector move in. The same thing has happened in Earth observations over the last 10 years. Used to be all Earth observation from space was done by the government. Now you've got private companies seeing a profit motive in doing that. So, all right, back to Branson and Bezos. Both of them are trying to develop space tourism. Is there a way to actually make a profit off of taking people to space? Maybe. We'll see. Certainly right now, it's only affordable by the very few. Will there be enough? And both of them, I will say, are very passionate about this. They hope that what they're doing will drive down the cost, make the technology more safe and more reliable and easier. Again, that drives down the cost, more accessible to more people, so that space starts to be for everyone, not just for a few government-supported astronauts. I don't see any threat to NASA from this. NASA shouldn't be doing that. Why would NASA get into the space tourism business? And the more private companies can take over part of what NASA does, NASA can focus on what's really hard, getting humans to Mars, developing that telescope that's going to image a planet around another star. So it allows NASA to stay focused on what NASA should be focused on, which is that cutting edge of exploration and discovery, where there is no profit motive. And I think the thing we're really waiting over the next decade or so is to watch, is there really a profit motive in space tourism? We'll see.
Okay. So what lessons have you learned from studying extremophiles on Earth that apply to life beyond Earth?
Really good question. I will say the understanding of extremophiles actually really moved this whole talk I gave today, was really moved forward by the discovery of extremophiles on Earth. And what extremophiles are, for those of you who don't know, are usually sort of single-cell bacteria-type organisms that we've discovered on Earth in the craziest environments, the hottest parts of eruption vents on the ocean floor. We find stuff living at extraordinarily high temperatures. We have found living organisms in the coldest of places here on Earth in Antarctica. When we dig into mines kilometers below the surface of the Earth, we find bacteria and single-celled organisms living down there in radioactive waste. Remember, I went on this whole thing about how radiation breaks apart organic molecules? Okay, we have organisms that here on Earth have actually evolved to be resistant to radiation and live in radioactive waste. We have these, my favorite things, they're called water bears or tardigrades, these little tiny organisms here on Earth that we've taken out into space, left them out into space. Some, you know, they're undergoing radiation, incredibly cold and hot temperatures. You bring them back in, you put them in some water, and they come back to life all happy. So life is tough, man. It evolves to adapt to really complicated environments. It can survive incredibly complicated environments and very challenging environments. So all of a sudden, scientists start thinking, wait a minute, our idea that planets have to be just right and planets have to be, you know, at just this right temperature and these right conditions, we've seen life, where it can get a hold, it does. And so it's made us incredibly optimistic that even in crazy places like Europa, Enceladus, Mars, even crazy Venus, and maybe even at a place like Titan, maybe we could find life, because what life on Earth has told us is life is tough, it's ubiquitous, and if it can get a toehold anywhere, it does.
Wow. Well, is there any reason to think that UFO sightings represent the existence of complex life elsewhere in the universe?
You know, I'm a skeptic, and let me break apart why I'm a skeptic. It certainly seems like there's phenomena that have been observed that are very difficult to explain. But first of all, let's get to the issue of complex life. So most of you know there's something called the Drake equation, or some of you might know there's something called the Drake equation by a guy named Frank Drake, who started to put together, can we sort of put together an equation that would talk about the likelihood of life in the solar system or in the universe? And it has to do like number of planets around stars, all kinds of different factors. The issue though around complex life that he has thought about has been, when you think about life here on Earth, it was nearly driven to extinction multiple times by factors from outside. Massive asteroid or comet hitting the surface of the Earth, radically changing the conditions, life nearly went extinct. That was the Cretaceous-Tertiary boundary. Other mass extinctions on Earth due to gigantic volcanic eruptions that changed the chemistry of the atmosphere, hugely affected Earth. The evolution of life that changed the chemistry of our own atmosphere actually helped make that life go extinct, new life form. So, and then you look at us who as humans, who we think we're pretty smart, right? We're a pretty complex life. And yet often we seem intent on trying to wipe each other out. And we also seem to, with climate change right now, we're really threatening the existence of biodiversity on this planet. So you think for a species to evolve to be complex and not wipe itself out or be wiped out is going to be really tough. If they get to that point, they then have to be able to develop propulsion that moves them near the speed of light. If you move near the speed of light, it will take you 17,000 years to get to the star nearest to Earth. So the distances between stars, between galaxies, is gigantic. And you can only go so fast. And so it takes really long time to get from here to there. So for a species to get to the point where they developed, you know, speed of light propulsion or faster than speed of light, which people debate whether that can happen, for them to come here, scare an airplane or a person and then leave, it just doesn't seem very likely to me, but I'm a skeptic.
Well, thank you again, Dr. Stofan, for sharing your time and expertise with us. And I'm sorry that we did not get to some of the other very interesting questions, but time's a flying. We hope that everyone has enjoyed today's live broadcast of the Monadnock Summer Lyceum. We thank you for your support of our unique 2021 season. Please join us next week to hear Paula Stone Williams speak on As a Woman, What I Learned About Power, Sex, and Patriarchy After I Transitioned. And until then, live long and prosper.